All right, Treasurer, thanks for joining SBS.
Thanks, Anna.
For someone thinking about whether they can pay their bills this week, what's in this budget for them?
Well, I'd say to the people who are under pressure, we understand these cost of living stresses and strains that you're under, and more help is on the way in this budget. So the budget I release tonight will have a tax cut for every taxpayer. It will have energy bill relief for every household, and there will be targeted cost of living relief too for renters, for cheaper medicines, and in other ways as well.
You maintain that this energy bill relief, $300 per person, no matter their income, from the wealthiest to the poorest in the country, will not fuel inflation. But economists are already suggesting that they disagree with that. Why don't you agree with the economists?
Oh, well, there's not a unanimous view amongst economists. There very rarely is, and there isn't on this occasion. You know, the very clear advice that we received is that a combination of our cost of living policies, particularly our energy bill relief and our rent assistance, will push downward pressure on inflation without adding to inflationary pressures elsewhere in the economy. There will always be a range of views about that, but we're pretty confident we got it right.
You made a very bold statement in this document about inflation when it reaches target band before Christmas. That's ahead of what the Reserve Bank says. I noticed in the speech you're delivering tonight, there's a perhaps. Is it now too late to rein that in? People are now expecting this forecast to become a reality. And will you be held to the same standard as Philip Lowe, who gave his interest rate forecast, but it didn't come true?
Well, first of all, the interest rate assumptions in the budget just rely on the market assumptions. And the inflation forecast is done by professional economists in the Treasury. And we've made it clear ever since we first made public these inflation forecasts that inflation is difficult to forecast at the best of times, and these are volatile times. But the very strong expectation of the Treasury is that the combination of our responsible economic management and the way we've designed our cost of living help will put downward pressure on inflation, and that could mean an earlier return to the target band. And that's the reason why there's a different set of forecasts for the time being between the Treasury and the Reserve Bank, is because the Treasury's forecasts take into consideration the budget that I released tonight.
If it doesn't happen, do you expect the voters to come at you with a baseball bat?
Oh, I leave the kind of political expectations and commentary to others.
I guess what I'm saying, like, I appreciate that, but I guess what I'm saying is the suggestion is that an interest rate moderation would follow. And so if this doesn't unfold the way you are hoping it does, what do you think that the Australian public will say?
Well, I think people understand that we're doing our best to get on top of this inflation challenge, which is absolutely punishing people around the kitchen tables of this country. You know, we understand people are under pressure. More help is on the way in this budget, and we've designed it in a way to be part of the solution rather than part of the problem.
How many people have to lose their jobs in order for us to achieve this inflation forecast?
Well, what we are attempting to do, and what we've been able to do so far, is to see inflation come off substantially at the same time as we maintain a pretty low unemployment rate.
There is a difference, though. Do you know how many people end up in the unemployment queue to get there?
Well, even as the unemployment rate ticks up a little bit in the Treasury's expectations, in the forecasts I released tonight, we will still be creating extra jobs in our economy. So the unemployment rate goes up a little bit, but we are creating more jobs for people. And that is consistent with what we've been able to achieve so far. We've created 780,000 jobs under the life of this government as inflation has moderated. And that shows that we can be attentive to the labour market at the same time as we get on top of inflation.
Just in terms of the international student conundrum that you're facing, will universities have to build essentially a dwelling for every additional visa holder they accept into a course?
Oh, not necessarily one for one, but as we negotiate the managed growth in our universities, one of the things that we want to speak with the universities about is a formula or a ratio or some other way of ensuring that if they want to bring in more foreign students, they need to build more student accommodation. One of the reasons why we've got pressure on our housing market is because we've seen this growth in students. International students are a very important part of our economy. They're a very important part of our universities. We don't want to introduce that, but we do want to make sure that we are building, or they are building, the housing that we'll need.
The future made in Australia policy, for it to work, people have to want to buy Australian solar panels at a premium. So would your government consider putting a tariff on Chinese solar panels?
Oh, there's a separate consideration about something which is called a CBAM, a carbon border adjustment mechanism. That's not part of the Future Made in Australia policy that I'm announcing tonight with my colleagues.
But could it be?
Well, we've said before that we will keep an eye on international developments around that, and Chris Bowen is doing some work on that. But primarily, this is not just about solar panels. It's about this vast industrial and economic opportunity presented to Australia and Australians by the global transformation to net zero. And that's why we want to attract more investment. We want to give a tax break for production in areas like renewable hydrogen and processing critical minerals, because the future of our economy is a combination of these industries in the Future Made in Australia policy and the care economy. And in the budget, there's investments in both those sets of industries.
And it's a huge policy area, and one will no doubt be dissecting for a long time to come. I just want to take you to a few of the sort of details of the budget. One of those is the target of 8 out of 10 Australians to have a tertiary education by 2050. What's the number now? Like, what's the gap you need to reach?
It's about 60% now, and we don't think that's enough. And Jason Clare, the Minister, and others, I think we all recognise that if we want to build a future made in Australia, we want to modernise our economy and maximise our opportunities, we need to make sure we've got the human capital base, the skills and higher education. And so the target will go from about 60% of the workforce now to about 80% by 2050. And that is absolutely crucial to ensuring people can do good, secure, well-paid jobs, and we can grow our economy the right way.
And just briefly, the NDIS change is enormous, $14.4 billion, if I read the document correctly, to be found or being found in that policy area. So which disability support won't exist?
Oh, no. What we're doing here is we're recognising that our highest priority is to provide the services for people who need and deserve help via the NDIS.
But there's got to be
that
cuts
number,
to...
No, it'll still grow quite quickly. It won't be cut backwards. We're talking about really still quite substantial growth. But the $14 billion figure that you reference is about the legislation which is going into the Parliament, which is all about making sure that we get on top of some of these escalating costs so we get value for money in the scheme so that it serves the people it's designed to serve.
So are you saying that there was $14.4 billion of sort of waste and rorts and mismanagement in the system?
Well, we have indicated in the past and indicating again that there is work that can be done to make sure we're getting value for money, even as the cost of the scheme continue to grow and even as we continue to provide those services.
So will any disability groups no longer have access to the NDIS under this proposal?
This change that we have in the system is all about the legislation, the impacts of the legislation. There is next to this quite a substantial increase in spending on the NDIS, including spending on cracking down on fraud in the scheme.
There's no money in the budget for Makarrata and Treaty. Is the Uluru Statement from the Heart no longer being funded by the federal government on any level?
Well, what we've done is we've reallocated some of that funding just in recognition of the circumstances, and also because we're making billions of dollars in new investments in our First Nations people and communities. There's a big investment in jobs in communities and a big investment in housing, as well as health and in a number of other areas. And so we've repurposed that money in the budget for some of these really pressing priorities.
Just in terms of, I've asked you before, humanitarian aid, Gaza, and dealing with people who are trying to flee that violence, why not change the visa status for people coming to Australia so they can work and access Medicare?
Well, this is primarily a consideration for my colleagues in the relevant portfolios. I'm obviously very alive to the situation in the Middle East and also all of the tension in other parts of the world as well. We try and do the best we can in the visa system for people. I rely very heavily on the advice of my colleagues.
Can you say hand on heart that people's living standards have improved under your government?
I can say hand on heart that every minute that we have been in government has been about helping to ensure that people can earn more, keep more of what they earn, we get real wages growing again, because that's the best way to turn around this challenge that we have with living standards and particularly with inflation.
So is the reality that living standards have decreased but your government couldn't do anything about it?
No, we're turning things around, and the most important way, or the most obvious way that we're doing that, is for the first time in years we've got real wages growing again. We've got tax cuts for every taxpayer. You know, we're providing cost of living relief in other ways, and that's about recognising that people are under pressure, but more than that, it's about doing something about it.
We thank you for your time again. Look forward to seeing you soon.
Thanks very much, Anna.